back to another episode of Collider Jedi Council. I'm Kristian Harloff, a.k.a. Darth Harloff, and guess what? This is our Star Wars show, and as a Star Wars fan, I'm losing my mind once again. What a month we're having on this show. I am so excited for our guests, and yeah, I guess our regular guests, too, our regular panel here. It's nice to have them, but come on.
Yeah, I'm excited to be here,
you
too.
You know that it is cool to have you, but not. I'm geeking out today. But first, sitting next to me, it is the Smith Lord. She's back. Tiffany Smith, hello.
I am back, and I'm excited to be back, and I agree with you. We've had some pretty stacked councils this month, and this is going to be another great one, so
this
I'm excited to have you guys on the show today.
This is going to be a great one, and the person who will be shelving out all the questions today and talking Star Wars like he always does, it's Mark 2D2, Mark Ellis.
Well, thank you very much, Kristian, and never more so than today have I been disappointed to not be the baseball player, Mark Ellis.
That's right. And we have our little fancy names here that we've given ourselves. But Lucasfilm and the Star Wars universe has given these guys their names. Let's start with Obi Wan Kenobi is here. It's James Arnold Taylor. What's
Yay.
Up, man?
Yes, the force is strong here indeed. Yes.
I am so excited to finally talk Star Wars with you, man.
Oh, man, it's going to be fun. We're going to have a good time.
You know? And sitting next to you, the great Ahsoka Tano herself, Ashley Eckstein, is here.
Hi, I'm so excited to be here.
It's going
to
be a lot of fun, all of us. We're really stoked. Thank you guys, seriously, for joining us.
Yeah. This will be the kinder, gentler version, because we are like the yes. apple pie of Star Wars, Ashley and I. Like,
so what are you trying to say Sam
good.
And Freddie are then?
They are what they are. They know. They
so
know.
We had the dark side the other week, and yeah. now we have the light side. Yeah,
right. We're the rated G version That's right. of Star Wars.
We had the dark side and the blind side, I guess.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep, that's true.
Okay, so if you didn't know how this works before, it's pretty easy. We're going to start off with a segment simply called Star Wars Movie News. Everything in the world of Star Wars that's happening in the movies. Episode 7, 8, 9, Rogue One, Han Solo. What's the next one? We don't know, but there's certainly a lot of news out there about them. Mark, what's up first?
Well, Kristian, we finally know who Rey's parents are. Or we know that they weren't in a movie, and no, maybe they were in that movie. This is all J.J. Abrams' comments from last week. He was being interviewed by the greatest living comedian of our time, Chris Rock, and he initially said that Rey's parents are not in Episode 7, so he can't possibly say this moment who they are, but it is something that Rey thinks about too. And then the predictable media firestorm erupted afterwards, and he clarified his comments to Entertainment Weekly, saying, "What I meant was that she doesn't discover them in Episode 7. Not that they may not already be in her world, so maybe, Kristian, they were in Episode 7. Maybe she is still a Skywalker or a Solo or something else." You saw these comments from J.J. Abrams. I'm sure your Twitter feed lit up. What did you think about it?
Being lit up is the understatement of the year. which to me, it was a non-story. It's a non-story. The fact that he says, okay, wait a minute. I believe him. I believe that he meant the fact that she didn't find them in Episode 7. And then everyone started freaking out going, wait a minute. You've got to make sure that you clarify exactly what you meant there. And he's like, okay. He's like, I'm not even directing the next movie. And it's like, so look, and I've told you from my stances, I still think that she's his daughter. And if she has,
she's Luke's daughter.
Not J.J. Abrams, yes.
And I happen
to think that if it turns out that she's just a Padawan, a la Revan from the Knights of the Republic that had the memory kind of wiped and now she's rediscovering herself, that's possible too. We'll see, but I don't take any of these comments I don't worry about it the way a lot of people are freaking out about it.
Does James, it matter? Yeah. Does it matter if her parents are somebody that we know or not? Or, you know, that's
yes.
the thing. Like, why? But why? I mean, it didn't matter if we knew who Luke's parents were until we found out that we needed to know yeah. who they were and it was important to us. You
because
know?
I think the reason is this, for why people care. Because for me, my reasoning why I think I would like her to be a Skywalker is because as of right now, we know that the only one that carried on the lineage right now is Ben Solo, and that didn't turn out so good.
Now, what if she's a Kenobi?
What if
I
she's
like
a Kenobi?
How you turned into Kenobi while you were doing that.
I'm yeah. also, I'm not going to lie, as you were reading the story, I'm looking at the two of them, and Ashley like looks over and smiles, and I'm like,
what
does
she
that,
know?
Does that mean she knows
we,
something?
She
know.
See, that's why
no,
we can
no, no,
act
no.
as though we know everything.
Exactly. Well,
is that what you're reporting, Mark?
You know, I do wonder, though, if J.J. Abrams, if he realizes that every single word is picked apart and if he plays with our emotions on purpose or if it really is an accident. Because one thing we've learned is that, you know, literally every single word is picked apart. Right. And, you know, going into the finale of Star Wars Rebels that just happened, like, I just stopped tweeting. Yeah. just anything yeah. that had to do with Star Wars, because I didn't want to ruin it one way or the other. And I didn't want even one word that I typed for someone to feel like I gave it away. And so I do wonder, was that a mistake or did he just want to have major news and he did that on purpose? Right. Who knows?
That was the thing with the whole issue of Obi-Wan saying Rey in the movie. When I had tweeted that I had originally done the lines, everybody went, oh, that must mean that she's connected to Obi-Wan Kenobi. I'm like, right. How does it mean that? They just asked me to come in and read it. It doesn't mean anything. Right, right. You know?
So. I know you joked about it, though, too, but would you like to see her? I mean, if you know them, we'll move on. But would you like to see her like be part of the Kenobi lineage? Because we did find in Clone Wars that Obi-Wan, in fact, did have feelings for somebody, and we don't know what happened or did not happen in those times between the Clone Wars up until Jedi, until New Hope. So do you think that it's a possibility?
You know, if they're willing to look at the Clone Wars and pull that in, and obviously it's canon, but if they're really taking it serious, because I loved the arc with Satine. I thought that was a really kind of important thing for Obi-Wan, and it was a great moment. So I think it'd be cool, but again, I think people were reading a lot into it, as Ashley says. It's just anytime we open our mouths, they're like, oh, it's like,
what they say? Right.
Well, look, there's two factors at play, and I'm going to be the idiot that reads way too far into this. One of which is when you see The Force Awakens, that movie hints that Rey's parents are somebody special. It's not like when you meet Luke Skywalker and it's like, oh, okay, this guy's from, you know, the middle of nowhere. I don't really care who his parents are because I don't know who I'm supposed to. But there's multiple times in Force Awakens when we're about to hear something about Rey's backstory and it cuts away. It's like what Maz Kanata is about to talk to Han about something, and it's like, ah, we're not going to tell you that yet. So I feel like they knew they were teasing us with what her lineage is. And then more to the point with J.J. Abrams is that him and the rest of the cast and crew did such a great job of keeping the shroud of secrecy for Episode 7 until it was released. Like, there were no spoilers that got out about that movie, which is a phenomenal achievement. And I think sometimes afterwards you just breathe this huge sigh of relief, like, okay, I don't know anything about anything anymore, and I can just talk normally. Yeah. And then maybe JJ's guard wasn't up. He's in a fun interview with Chris Rock. He just let something slip. So either way, it's interesting for me. I think that her parents are going to be a big part of the story. But from Daisy Ridley's own mouth, she's like, look, that's not what we should be focusing on. We should be focusing on what Rey's journey going forward is. Yeah. And I agree with that as well.
Well, and I think that the second what he followed up with didn't really change the first statement, because he was like, she doesn't know who they are. That doesn't mean they were in the movie. Like, right. That doesn't change the fact that he said, we haven't seen them in The Force Awakens, which is fine. To me, that's like, okay, just because we haven't seen them, it could be Obi-Wan, it could be a character that we know. Just because we haven't seen them doesn't mean it's a character that we don't already, as Star Wars fans, have a connection to in some way.
And playing off what Ashley said as well, too, is that they could, if JJ was indeed messing with us, then he could have said, well, because their parents, maybe her mom wasn't in the movie, and she's in Episode 8, and then Luke and her mom are in the same movie together. Now her parents were in the movie. You know what I mean? It's like,
from what I told you, is true from a certain point of view.
Exactly. Okay, moving on, Mark. What's next?
Well, there's good news, Kristian. Episode 8 has a set that we can all visit, but we have to be English royalty. Prince Harry and Prince William both got a tour of the Episode 8 set, and they got to take the coolest fan pictures ever in such things as, maybe was that an A-Wing? Was that a Y-Wing? What was that spaceship he was in next to Mark Hamill? And one of them actually got to fight lightsabers with Rian Johnson in a video that was released too. So Kristian, you saw these images. There's a lot of cool stuff going on there. I don't know that we can glean a lot about any mysteries involved in Episode 8, but this must have been a great experience for people who have had great experiences in their lives being English royalty.
For everyone except for the person who had to dress up as Chewie that day because he thought he had the day off. He's like, oh wait, all right, I'll dress up. But I'll tell you, looking at those pictures, yeah, of course it's cool, because it just, again, just throws us into the fact that Episode 8 is shooting right now. We're in the middle of it. We're getting ready for it. It's exciting. And then I love the fact that you have both royalty holding Daisy Ridley's head at one point. Why is her head? What are they doing with her head? What is that? This movie's going to be dark. Like, is it going to be another kind of inside the cave moment?
They explained that. They said it's for her stunt double.
It's a mask. We don't think she's getting beheaded this early.
Not this early.
But then they wouldn't show it. Decapitated Rey head.
I'd be a little bit more concerned. Yeah.
Here's a little insight for you, though. Ashley is a huge fan of the Royals. She loves everything.
So I was about to say, I have several thoughts about this visit. Maybe not so much what you guys were thinking, but I am dreaming about Prince Harry and Daisy Ridley getting together. I mean, can we just talk about the fact that they need to become a couple? Yeah. Yeah. That's what I took away from that visit. Okay. And they would make beautiful babies.
So you're
and
shipping,
Daisy Ridley.
You're shipping dairy.
I'm ship. Yes.
Dairy.
I am shipping dairy.
I just did.
That's
yeah.
Great.
Okay. So A, that was my takeaway. B, okay. So I've known, because I'm obsessed, that that Prince William and Prince Harry have been huge Star Wars fans. So they had Star Wars posters in their bedroom when they were kids. The reason I know this is because I secretly believe that I am meant to be best friends with Kate Middleton.
sending Ahsoka messages to their phones.
Yes. So I don't really care about Prince William and Prince Harry, but if it's like a couple degrees of separation. Mm. If Prince William is a Star Wars fan, which now proves he is, somehow we're involved in Star Wars. Like, yes. I'm totally several degrees of separation back.
Yeah.
But it's closer. I'm a little bit closer now. So Kate, the Force is strong with our friendship.
I love it.
This is a huge moment in the history of Jedi Council.
Why is that?
Because, yes, we've had people on here promoting their new show, promoting their new movie. Now we have celebrities come on the show to grovel about wanting to meet the royals. Yeah. This is awesome.
And matchmaking.
I mean, I will say, I feel like this cardigan could be something that Kate Middleton could wear.
So you totally know that Prince George and Princess Charlotte are going to become Star Wars fans. It's just going to happen. And Kate is going to throw them a Star Wars birthday party, and she's going to need something Star Wars to wear.
Right. It's true. Yeah.
It's going to happen.
And a message from Ahsoka.
Exactly.
I actually really enjoyed the lightsaber pictures of the two of them fighting, and there was one particular picture, I don't know if we have it out here, but when they were, I think Rian Johnson was fighting with Harry, and on the table there was a lightsaber in a design that I had never seen before. Mm-hmm. And it was like black and red, looked like Maul. I can't imagine it's going to be Maul's, but I mean, I the more and more I think about it, I think Benicio Del Toro is going to wind up playing a Sith Lord.
It was It was in the video of them lightsaber fighting. And then you could see on the table behind them some new looking lightsaber.
They had to know that was in the shot though.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah.
I mean, the crazy thing too is, yes, they're on set, but we don't know if this is stuff that's from The Force Awakens that's not being used in episode 8 right
now. No, Rian Johnson was there.
But I'm saying it's still like
they're keeping all
the stuff that's right there.
There was no A-Wing in
but
The Force
But I'm saying
Awakens.
The props and stuff
Guys,
that's
we'll
there.
See the movie in December.
They could also, just knowing how it kind of works sometimes, I'm sure a lot of that was like, okay,
it was
let's
staged.
Put this here.
Yeah.
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 Right.
The part of it that really stood out to me, though, was there was a point where in the video, Harry is talking to Chewbacca, and I was like, Chewbacca doesn't talk. Like, stop having a normal conversation with him.
You don't know.
He wasn't making noises. They were like talking to each other, and he's like, "Yeah, na na na." And I was like, "No,
he does talk."
Wait a second.
Like in English.
Oh, okay.
Basic.
Yes. Basic. Yeah. No.
Yes.
We talk to Chewie all the time.
Totally. Do you think Prince Harry had a pickup line to Daisy Ridley about Chewbacca?
Dairy.
Hashtag dairy.
Hashtag dairy. All right, Mark. What's next?
Well, Kristian, we have breaking news. Kate Middleton is now following Ashley Eckstein on Twitter.
Don't
and then
tease
we
her.
Move on to our next story, which is Oscar Isaac talking about that movie we just yapped about, episode 8, saying that it feels like they're making an independent film. This is on the heels of Lawrence Kasdan talking about Rian Johnson's movie. It's going to be like nothing we had ever seen with Star Wars. And when Isaac echoed those sentiments, he said that it's like you're on the set of an independent movie because they're dealing with very intimate moments with characters that have yet to be explored in the Star Wars universe. Kristian, this seems to be pointing the way that we always thought a Rian Johnson-made Star Wars movie would, that it's going to look very different. And like you said before, you don't bring in Rian Johnson just for Sunshine and Roses. You bring him in for dark, intimate details. How do you feel about these comments?
I love it. James and I were speaking about this before we went on the air today, too, and I'm actually looking forward to episode 8, I think, more than I've ever looked forward to any Star Wars movie. Because I know you called me out. You're like, no way. And I'll tell you what. And look, Force Awakens, it's different. Force Awakens, we hadn't seen a Star Wars movie in so long, and that kind of hype, you're never going to be able to recapture that. But the fact that I'm so invested now in these characters, the fact that I really, because I didn't know if I figured I'd be invested in the episode 7 characters, but I didn't know. Now I know. And now I know Rian Johnson, a guy who's done movies like Looper and Brick, and a dude that's going to bring such a different spin to the Star Wars universe. That, to me, has me excited. And to hear Oscar Isaac saying it feels like an indie film, I want this film to feel like an indie film. you're going to see the scale of it because it's Star Wars. You're going to see how big the production is and all that. But I want the story to feel like an independent film. I want it to feature more about the intricate workings of the character and who they are. Like, that's what I want. And if a guy like Oscar Isaac, who has been known to be in a few independent films here and there and do really well, says it is, I believe it. But Ashley, you hear these comments. What do you think?
You know, I was a bit confused because I'm like, is it going to look more like an independent film or is he just talking about story? And I think he's more just talking about the story and the acting. But I hope it is too. I loved Episode 7, but it was kind of like a reboot, a little bit of what we already knew and rebooting a new franchise. So I wanted a bit more meat there. And I hope we get that with Episode 8. I hope we get more story and development because I feel like we just got a nice surface level introduction to these characters, but now I want more.
Yeah, it's, you know, the thing is, I'm probably the only one in this room that was actually around and alive when Star Wars came out. You're all too young. But there was a feeling when Empire came out of its own film. It's not Star Wars. It's not like, you know, sequels always go, oh, now we're going to do that joke that we did in the first one. Remember how cool we're going to do it? They didn't do any of that. It was a whole new thing. And so I think people need to remember that's what they're doing here and that's why they're getting different directors. Getting, you know, JJ's got his eye on this stuff, but they're giving each one a different feel. I think it's important. Yeah. I think it's really cool.
I totally agree with almost everything you guys are saying because I do think The Force Awakens was amazing, but I do think what it needed to do was set that groundwork again. It reintroduced people who maybe have never seen the movies to characters that we all know and love and introduce us to new characters. So you couldn't dive that deeply into relationships. So with this new movie where you're hearing Oscar say, you know, it is really about the interactions, the small moments between characters, makes me super excited because that's exactly what The Force Awakens put me in a position to want. Mm-hmm. Because you're ready now. You know these characters and you're like, well, now I want to see Luke and Daisy interact. And not Luke and Daisy. Sometimes I do that. I'm like, real
Lazy.
Name, character
Lazy.
Name. Yes. Yeah. As the name and how my brain was working at the moment.
It's a double entendre. Yeah, that's French.
But I agree that I think, you know, someone like Oscar Isaac saying that it feels like an independent film carries a lot of weight because he has done some pretty incredible independent films. I mean, Ex Machina is one of my favorite movies. And so for him going off of that set and then obviously getting to work with Donald Gleason on that film as well makes me curious to see what's their interaction going to be like in this movie. I think it's in great hands and everything that they're saying is making me that much more excited for the new film.
Mark 2D2?
Yeah, I mean, this being an indie film makes a lot of sense. It's not just like they're going to be hanging out with Jay and Silent Bob out front of a New Jersey grocery store. Like, there's a lot of great indies out there because they focus on storytelling. My personal favorite independent film of all time is a little movie you may have heard of called Star Wars, A New Hope. It's great, and you guys should all check it out at home if you haven't seen it yet. I love the way this movie's going so far.
I've heard of that film. Okay, what's next?
Well, first of all, I want to give a big shout-out to StarWarsNewsNet.com. They're not only a great aggregator of other Star Wars scoops, but they also break their own stories from time to time as well. It's where we get a lot of our info, and it makes me seem very smart on this very show. Our next story is about costumes
Potential
in Episode
spoiler.
8. Potential spoiler, is that these are how the costumes might, maybe, kind of, could possibly look. Now, you see Daisy Ridley there first, where she's got that cool-looking jacket, and it's got some shoulder pads on there, which were big in the late 80s, and apparently whenever Episode 8 comes out. And then you see Mark Hamill's look, and it's a different look than we saw him have at the end of Episode 7. And Kristian, dare I invoke the name of my favorite movie of any kind of all time, Return of the Jedi. Yeah. It looks like he kept those duds around and still fits into them okay.
It does. But I'm actually going to defer to her universe over here because you talk about style and you talk about looks. I want to talk about what you think of these looks. Is this as far as, can we throw that image up there again, Jonathan? Like, so if we, because, Adam, sorry. Well, you left it, you took it off too fast, so I got your name wrong. Which, do these kind of stand out? And does that look a little bit like Finn and or Poe's jacket a little bit too on the right?
Yeah.
Well, that
does,
one on
yeah.
the right is what she had on.
You mean the left?
Well,
the one on the left.
This is what she had on at the end of The Force Awakens. It was the vest and the arms and the shoulders were cut out. And then the other one still has the arms and it looks like the same pants and shoes, but different top.
How do you feel about this look?
Yeah, I think the looks are great. And I think you can tell when a costume is a hit and when it's a success, when you see people in cosplay or in costumes. And I think the thing that I was hoping for and it's exceeded expectations is the amount of people who've been cosplaying as Rey, and all ages, little girls all the way to adults. I went to WonderCon and I went to Emerald City Comic Con, and there were Reys everywhere. And that literally just warmed my heart to see, because I think somebody, it's a simple costume. I mean, I love Ahsoka Tano, but that's a very hard costume to do. Yeah. Rey, I think, is a simple costume. Anyone can do it, but it's cool. Everyone wants it. And Luke Skywalker, he's got some fashion there.
He looks good. What do you think of this
look? He looks good.
I think it's very cool. I want to cosplay as Rey too, I think. Every young Jedi wants to. No, and again, like Jedi, you know, like Mark's talking about, it's nice to look back and see that there's a hint of that. That's important that we have some of that, because who is this guy? What's he going to be about? I mean, that's the story we all want to know. I mean, I just get a kick out of, I think back, you know, when Mark came to Star Wars Weekends a few years back when they were making the movie, he had the beard and all that. And I'm thinking, I'm just picturing him after that going to London and sitting in a trailer for like months until he comes out and just stands on a rock. You know?
right.
So they could fool everybody. So I'm guessing he's had some input in this too. He's looked at this stuff and said, no, I want, you know.
I bet you're right. Because the thing was, Luke was never just the pure, he was always the mix. He was like, because when he shows up in Return of the Jedi in that outfit that you referenced, Mark, that's, and especially when you go back into the history after watching that movie, most Jedi don't show up in all black and in the black robe. But he was the kind of a balance, even though it was the prophecy that Anakin was the balance. He seemed to me to be that balance of the light and the dark, and even dressed as much. So this makes sense that he would be dressed like this. Do you like the look?
Oh, yeah. I'm just losing my mind a little bit as to how great this is. Because you're right. In Return of the Jedi, he shows up. Not only does he show up as somebody as powerful as a real Jedi Knight, he's got the black look on. The first thing he does is he force chokes two Gamorrean guards. That is dark stuff, man. So the fact that he's still got a costume like this potentially means that he is still a man of action. He's not just sitting on the sidelines. He's not just like Yoda, where he's just going to hang onto her back like they made fun of in that Twitter pic a couple weeks ago. He's still capable of kicking some ass. Mm-hmm. That's who Luke Skywalker is.
And he should be,
Well, and I think the cool thing about the look, too, is even with Rey's, it's more reminiscent to me of Luke when he was training. That it looks very much like that, and it looks like she can be really active, and that while he's training her, that may be her go-to look. The interesting part to me is his looks much more, not conservative, but like business. They're gonna go into town and they're gonna do some stuff, and hers is much more like training and light and easily movable. So it'll be curious for me to see if those two costumes are within the same scenes or if they're from different points in the movie.
This also looks to me like your guys' next job, because I think that they're gonna make an episode 7, 8, 9, around that. That's gonna be the next animated series.
Yeah,
I think
that
kind of look will be in there. So I'll make a prediction. I guarantee you'll hear these voices on that show.
It does
when
look
it happens.
Pretty nice. And we should point out that they don't just hire anybody off the street to do these costume designs. They have Michael Kaplan doing it.
Right.
His earliest work was, I think, Blade Runner, which is a nice intro into sci-fi. Yeah. He also did Star Trek. He did Fight Club. This guy knows what he's doing.
Yeah. Okay, what's next?
Next up is a guy who does know what he's doing as well, particularly when it comes to acting in Rian Johnson movies. A kid named, well, he's a dude now, I guess, Noah Segan might be playing a role in Episode 8. And this is important because Rian Johnson has used him in a number of his movies. I think he's actually been in every feature film that Rian Johnson has made. If you go back to Brick, or you go back to Looper, The Brothers Bloom, he also made a cameo during an episode of Breaking Bad that Rian Johnson directed, the very popular Ozymandias episode. So this guy was reported as going to London, and there's speculation that he's on set of Episode 8. So Kristian, you take a look at that young man. Who do you think he's going to be in Episode 8?
No idea. But, but what I'll tell you, I buy it 100%. If we're buying or selling here, because it makes sense. A lot of directors will use people they've used before because they're comfortable sometimes as even favors. Not to say that this is that, but I mean, look at something like J.J. Abrams and Grunberg, who've been friends forever, and you know, and he put him in Episode 7. He puts him in everything. So to have this happen, I also think that we're going to see a Joseph Gordon-Levitt type of Daniel Craig situation too, to where Levitt will pop in there somewhere or another, whether he's an alien or something. We don't even know until afterwards. So yeah, I mean, this makes sense to me.
Yeah, I mean, I think that initially you're like, okay, yeah, there have been people who visited the Force Awakens set who weren't a part of the movie. Obviously, we heard that with Daniel Craig, and then he ended up being in it. And this is the fact that he's been in every single one of his films that he's done. It makes sense that he's going to have some kind of a role in this one. And just seeing him in that shot, which I don't... What is this from? Do we know?
His backyard.
Headshots in Los Angeles. Yeah. But just the way his hair is there even, and the necklace, and like the kind of Henley shirt, it looks like he's like along the lines of Jedi training, kind of that vibe that he could be. So I feel like he has a look that would fit into the world pretty easily.
James, yeah. Are you familiar with this gentleman? And if not, does he have the look to be in a Star Wars film?
He, you know, yeah, I'm familiar with him. And, you know, I mean, but it's the good luck charm thing. You know, it's you use people. And Oliver Stone did that in all of his. He always used all the same. I mean, there's so many directors that do that. And I think it makes sense. And so I don't know if we'll see him in a main role. I'm going to guess he's probably going to be in a smaller part. Because that's kind of become now the fun thing. Oh, you get to be in a Star Wars. Oh, I want to be in Star Wars. Come in and do something, you know. Right. So probably that.
And that was Clint Eastwood.
Yeah.
I feel like, too, there's something that's comfortable about it, where it's like he's taking on this massive movie, and to have someone, an actor that he's really comfortable with, that knows his directing style, that he could just throw in and be like, okay, I need you to help me out with this. And then it's a reminder of, like, look at all these movies I've done with you. We can do this kind of thing. So it's a good touchstone to have.
Ashley, what do you think?
You know, I don't know him, but I wish him well. And I think, you know, if he is in Star Wars, and I think the only thing I hope is when somebody new becomes a part of Star Wars is they realize how much of a gift it is. Yeah. I mean, I think we can say being a part of Star Wars really changed my life. And I feel like I won the lottery. Yeah. And to really respect the franchise, I think somebody that is a part of Star Wars that doesn't truly realize what a gift it is, you know, I think is doing a disrespect to the franchise. And so I'm sure he looks like a wonderful guy. I'm sure he is probably tickled pink to be on the set of Star Wars. But I think you know, I wish him well.
Yeah. Mark?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, it's your good luck charm, whatever. He looks like somebody who could figure. He looks like he could play Anakin. You know, he's got a Star Warsy look to him. So I'm totally on board with this.
All right, now I know you love this next story. Let's hit it. What do you got?
Kind of a big fan. Well, Star Wars Celebration is rapidly approaching. It's in London this year, and Warwick Davis, better known as Wicket the Ewok from Return of the Jedi, and a number of other great roles over his storied career, will be hosting. He's a celebrity host on the main stage during the weekend, which means he introduces a lot of the panels and stuff like that. He likes to have fun with the crowd. This guy is a world-class actor, improv artist. Mm-hmm. He's really, really funny on stage. So he's one of the short, no pun intended, he's on the short list to be a guy who can really handle a great Star Wars crowd, especially when it's going to be at fever pitch because of all the events they're going to be having at Celebration this year.
All right, so I'm definitely going to jump in afterwards because I got to talk to both you guys for different reasons. One, are you both going to be at Celebration? Yes?
Can you guys say?
No, I host the American versions, so I am the American version of Warwick Davis. So anytime we do the Star Wars celebrations here over the last few years, I've been lucky enough to be the host of the main stage, and they always give me a call and go, you know, it's gonna be Warwick in Europe. Okay, I get it. You know? And then they call Warwick, and then it's gonna be James here. And okay, fine. And we're all dear friends. I mean, we go way back with Warwick, and so I'm thrilled for him. I love the video he put out announcing it.
Yeah,
but actually, the celebration itself, and like the thing, like as far as panels and stuff, you guys don't know. You've got it. You haven't heard anything yet, as far as
no. I mean, at least for me, I'm still working that out. Okay. I will say from a timing perspective, it's right before San Diego Comic-Con, so we're still trying to figure a lot of that out. But I do have a funny story about Warwick Davis.
What do you got?
First of all, he is one of the nicest people ever, and his family
is just beautiful and lovely.
They're just so wonderful. Like, we could do a whole show just about how much we love the Davis family. But I got I leased a new car, and we were picking it up. It was me and my husband and the person from the car dealership, and working out the Bluetooth, and, you know, you hook your phone up and you talk through the car, and it says, like, call so-and-so. So I'm so embarrassed, but my nickname for my husband is My Boo. So it said, call My Boo. And that's what I had to say. Well, I said, call My Boo. And then Warwick Davis comes up in my car. I'm like, wait a minute. Warwick Davis is not My Boo. Like, how my car, when I said My Boo, came up with Warwick Davis, I don't know.
Because your heart knows that he is your boo.
Call Wicked.
Yes.
Can we pick up?
No, because I've had to approve it. But yeah, so Warwick Davis is my boo. Not really. But
have you told him that story?
No, I haven't yet.
Oh, that's amazing.
But I would. He's like I said, he's just a lovely guy, and we've had the opportunity to really spend every summer with him for the past several years.
That's seems like the coolest guy. Yeah. Did anybody else catch the HBO series he did, Life's Too Short?
Yeah.
It's so funny, and he's so good in it. Yeah. And he was recently on stage. He played Patsy in Spamalot on the West End in London, which is a great.
He,
it's a Monty Python.
He did it out here, too.
Did he really? I can't believe I missed it. Now, I'm a huge Monty Python and Warwick Davis fan. This is great news.
It is. I mean, I think that's, you know, and he's also, fans recognize him as part of the Star Wars universe. Sure. I mean, he's been in, what, three movies, right?
No, he's, well.
He was in episode one and did three different roles. And then episode.
And he was in Force Awakens.
And then he was in Jedi. So three movies, yeah. And so to have him, any time that he's, and I also am a big fan when you host the American version as
well,
too.
No, it's okay, it's fine. Yeah. Great for Warwick, yeah. Woo! All right, big news. Thanks, Mark.
Couldn't have left that story out.
Couldn't be a better host for Star Wars Celebration.
Yeah. In London.
I've got to do this just because you guys. I missed the interview in live studio. What would a Christopher Walken led Star Wars Celebration host look like?
Star Wars Celebration is huge. It's big. Ray, Paul, Finn, Luke, BB.
Thank you, Mr. Walken.
Good show.
Oh, so good.
Yeah, Warwick can't do that. So
this is what it was like in the studio all the time. It was James and Dee Bradley Baker just constantly cracking us up in between takes, and I just couldn't keep it together. These guys crack us up.
Well, you know, I'm back to Warwick. He has a wonderful show that he did every year at Star Wars Weekends with us, and I hope he brings it to the main stage there. I'm sure he will. It's called An Ewok's Tale, and he tells his whole story, and he's got these really great exclusive behind-the-scenes videos of working at, because, I mean, we're the same age. He was 11 years old when he did Jedi, and he was, like, the biggest Star Wars fan in the world, and then he got to be in the movies. So he's got wonderful stories. He's also just, as Ashley said, he's just one of the sweetest guys in the world, is great.
All right, what's next?
Well, what's up next is that, like we talked about, Noah Segan maybe making a small role in Episode 8, there's another famous actor that might have an even tinier role, a la what Daniel Craig was as the Stormtrooper in Episode 7. In Episode 8, there's a chance it could be Mr. Norman Reedus from Walking Dead fame. He's talking about, in a recent interview, Walking Dead, how it's opened so many doors for him, and he said that, you know, sometimes you're doing the same stuff, but you get other doors that are open, and anybody can have some success, get offered more things. He's not against blockbusters or indie films. He would do them if it's a good story and good people involved. Would he want to be a Stormtrooper in Star Wars? F yeah! It's a cool outfit! So, Kristian, maybe we get to see another celebrity cameo in a Stormtrooper costume. Now, for you, I know you brought up the name Joseph Gordon-Levitt. So, what are your current Vegas odds on who's going to be the famous Stormtrooper in 8? Is it going to be Norman Reedus, or is it going
to
be Levitt?
I'd rather it be Levitt. I would say no thank you to Norman Reedus as a Stormtrooper, because I want him in a role. He would have been perfect in Rogue One. He would have been perfect as one, like, a rebellion... part of the rebellion, fighting, or even on the Empire, but I think probably more on the rebellion. So let's hope that once his run on Walking Dead is over, or if he gets the hiatus period that he can be in, because we have so many more movies. We get one Star Wars movie a year. So whether it's during the time period of the saga films, or if it's in a Star Wars story or anthology, whatever it's called at this point, having him in one of those movies I think would be great. So I would say no on a cameo.
Can we just, this would be my dream role for him. Chewie has to go get the crossbow fixed. And he goes to Norman Reedus, and he's the one with the crossbows. Right. It would just be like such good fan service on both sides. And he could have a little bit more of a role, but it doesn't have to be anything too big. I would totally freak out if that happened.
It goes back to the story earlier about it feeling like an independent movie.
Yeah.
It would be great if he is in a part, as you say, though, where it is more, we get to kind of experience him as an actor, not just, you know, because I mean, it's a novelty to some degree of, oh, who's going to be in the Stormtrooper suit? You know, and it's great, but when you've got talent like that and you've got a movie that you're saying is really going to be kind of in-depth and indie feel, put him in there in a big role.
Yes, and also because I think the stormtrooper role and the gags are for people like a James Bond or Tom Cruise or someone like that, where it's not gonna, because what I thought Star Wars has done so well has been to cast people that when you see
aren't distracting
by
you who
see,
you know
see the
them
character,
as.
Not the celebrity. And I think that Norman Reedus could be one of those guys.
Well, if I saw Tom Cruise as a stormtrooper, you know what I'd say.
What?
Aren't you a little short for a stormtrooper?
Ashley?
Well, it's funny you say that because I had a hard time with Adam Driver because of that.
Girls.
Because of Girls. Mm. I really dislike his character on Girls. He's that good. Like, he's that good of an actor where I have a hard time separating.
Right.
And so I watched him as Kylo Ren, and I just, all I could, I just hated his character from Girls. And so, but Norman Reedus, I love Daryl so much that I would love to see him. So I hope, I agree with you. I hope we see him in one of the movies. I think he would have been perfect for Rogue One, but I hope it is out of costume.
Yeah. Mark?
I just want to hear, I think he's got a great voice for a stormtrooper. You know, he's just got that like growl kind of thing. And so when you hear that from a stormtrooper.
You know why he can't be a stormtrooper? Because he can hit his target.
Yeah. Very good. He could be a Wookiee. He's great with a crossbow.
That's true. Good, yeah. All right, last movie news story.
Well, we have yet another record that Star Wars The Force Awakens has broken. And yes, it once again involves money. Now, it's already over $900 million domestically at the box office. It broke that on day 50 of release. And now it has a Blu-ray record. Listen to this. This thing, obviously, we knew it was going to make gobs and gobs of money, but it outsold the remaining in the top 20 Blu-rays the week it was released. It outsold the other 19 combined because everybody went to the store that weekend to buy or ordered it off Amazon Prime and had the drone drop it off because everybody wanted to see The Force Awakens on Blu-ray. Shattering records. This comes as no surprise to you.
No surprise whatsoever. It's not only because it's the most popular movie in the last God knows how many years, it's also... it's part of the collection. So even, look, and I'll admit it, I've talked about how I'm not a huge fan of the prequels, but every time a new Blu-ray or something came out, I bought it to find out what was going on. Some of the best behind-the-scenes features that you're ever going to get in those. These were not great behind-the-scenes features, but you still got the movie. You got to see the movie again. You see it 5 times in the theaters. Now you can watch as many times as you want. Go out and get it. And that's what happened, and I'm not surprised at all. Are you guys surprised at all that this happened?
No, I'm very happy about it.
Yeah.
Because my name's in the credit. Oh, that'll be a good day. Yes, comes in. No, I'm sorry. Yeah, I was very happy. I learned from you guys about that. I thought it's a good thing. It's not a surprise, though. Everybody's got to collect it. You've got to have it. And then, of course, they'll come out with another one that you have to collect as well. Yeah.
Ashley, shocking at all that it broke those records?
No, not at all. I mean, I think, you know, especially having her universe, we've just seen the popularity of Star Wars just soar. And it was already popular, but The Force Awakens, it's like, it's even taken Star Wars to more of a mainstream level, which it was already mainstream. And but I think it's amazing because it's something, you know, the entire family can enjoy together now. I mean, my mother is calling me with Star Wars theories.
That's so
never
awesome.
In a million years would my mom be calling me with Star Wars theories.
She never did it with Clone Wars?
Only sometimes. But you know what the funny thing is? So this legitimately just happened. So we went to the season finale screening of Rebels up in San Francisco. My mom and dad, my aunt came out. And afterwards, my mom is telling Pablo Hidalgo, who is on the story group at Lucasfilm, she's telling him what just happened in the finale. And Pablo, he was such a good sport about it. But he was like, you know what? I need this as a show. I need all the Star Wars actors' moms and their theories.
Yeah. Oh, that's so good.
Oh, my God. I would watch that.
Yeah.
Does it shock you at all of this? All these
No, the only thing shocking about that is that I was not one of the people that bought the Blu-ray.
Yeah.
Like, because we got free copies, and I assumed I was going to be one of those people. Then I was on the road that weekend, and I turned on Schmoes to watch Christian host, and he's giving away Force Awakens Blu-rays left and right. And I'm like, oh, crap. I want one of them. Yeah. So you owe me a Blu-ray.
That lives in our office. Who are you kidding? That's it for the movie news. Now simply comes the part of the show that is called What's the Deal with Canon? Everything happening in the world of canon. Comic books, could be video games, could be a little show called Star Wars Rebels. There's a whole bunch of things that link us back into the world of Star Wars. Mark, You know what's first.
I do, yeah. We get to interview Ashley Eckstein and James Arnold Taylor. When do they come into studio?
They are actually here right now.
Oh, good.
Good. Yeah.
Oh, hey, guys.
Let's get into this, guys, because like I said in the beginning of the show, I'm so excited to have the both of you here to talk everything Star Wars, from your involvement to Clone Wars to the amazing seasons of Rebels that we've been having here, and just the introduction, the way you guys said you've been involved now in the history and the canon of Star Wars, which is so awesome.
Weird.
James, let's start with you, because I do want to get into the Obi-Wan Force Awakens tie-in, though, too.
Yeah.
Like you said, you tweeted it out.
Yeah.
Can you kind of give us a breakdown of how that all went down? I know you've talked about it, but just to kind of get into it a little bit more.
No, absolutely. So Matthew Wood, the brilliant Oscar-nominated sound designer for the film and for Clone Wars, called me up because I had been pestering him since they announced this whole thing how many years ago, and I said, you got to get me in to do ADR, you know, well, I want to be part of the Loop group and stuff. And he's like, okay. And so he called me in, and it was great. And then he said, we're putting this dream sequence together. This is in October, the end of October, and they were still not, they didn't have it figured out yet. And if you read about that, you find
October
that
it really, last year coming out. Wow.
So we came in and watched the movie in black and white with no sound.
What?
And you had to just go through and do all the cues and stuff and trying to, you know, but they kept a lot of things hidden from us. But he goes, so there's this sequence and we want you to do Obi-Wan in there. And he goes, I'm trying to kind of pitch this to JJ that it'd be good, because they had Frank Oz in to do some Yoda stuff already. And they didn't know it was going to be this kind of wonderful, it's one of my favorite moments in the film, even though I'm not in it anymore. I was hopeful that I was. And when I heard it, and everybody else heard it, they said, I think it's you. And I don't know. I go, how do you think? And there, finally, I asked him. He's like, no, that was Alec Guinness and Ewan McGregor. He goes, yeah, he pitched it to JJ, and it was such kind of a big thing. He went, it's a great idea. Let's get Ewan to do it. I was like, of course.
Right.
not the cartoon guy. But I went, Ray. All these variations of Ray, and they didn't have the whole line at that time yet, so it was fun. It was great. It was, you know, a piece of Star Wars history, and it took all three Obi-Wans to say the line, which I think is kind of cool.
Right.
But I'm on the cutting room floor.
What's that experience like, where you're just saying, getting to watch it in black and white and doing some of the ADR stuff, where you're in the room and you're just like, this is my first experience.
2 months before everybody's gonna see it. It was weird, because I was like, as a fan, I'm going, I don't know if I really want to see this.
Yeah.
You know, and you're seeing all the stuff for I was like the guys getting chewed up and eaten by the big, you know, roly poly ball there on the ship. The ship. Yeah. That's how you can tell I'm a Star Wars fan.
Yeah.
It's technical stuff. And, you know, you're doing
your favorite things
really
in the movie.
Weird.
What's my favorite?
They're called Rash Yards.
Oh, I got to be the, and we all lined up and did that. And then I was when Finn is looking for water.
Yeah.
And there's
that's cool. I know that moment well.
Some troopers. There was a moment that Matt Lanter and I had that was cutting. So you know when Kylo's going crazy?
Yeah, yeah.
And the two troopers come and they turn around and walk.
Mm-hmm.
Matt and I actually looped dialogue for that.
Oh, that's cool.
We were coming in talking. So how's it? I think we better go back this way. Yeah, great. You know, and we laughed. And it didn't need it, but it was fun to do, and it got a big laugh the day of, and we were hoping it would go because it would be Anakin and Obi-Wan.
Oh, that's pretty awesome.
But we were missing Ahsoka in that one, though, so that's the only thing. Yeah.
Well, speaking of Ahsoka, so we haven't gotten a chance to speak since the finale went down.
Before we even get into it, can we please talk about the shirt?
That's what I want to play into, because now you're not going to answer the question. I'm going to ask it anyway, because all the questions that were coming before the finale where was she gonna find out that Vader was Anakin? What does she know? Like all this stuff that you're like, finally, I don't have to answer that anymore. And now the new question. Is she dead? Is she alive? What's the deal with Ahsoka?
Well, I can honestly tell you that I don't know.
Okay.
Dave Filoni, for the first time in 10 years, has not told me. Hmm. And, we're all family. We've gotten to know each other really well. And I think this is his way of protecting me, which, you know, I have to say I don't really like. But then at the same time, I appreciate, because I think if I knew the truth, it would be so hard to like literally look you in the face and say, I don't know.
Right. So he's protecting you by not telling you.
Exactly. Yeah. So I really don't know if she's alive or if she's dead, where she is. I don't know. I will say, so this shirt I'm wearing, which I don't know if you can see. Okay,
yeah.
There you go.
Awesome.
Dave
shirt.
Designed it.
Oh, cool.
And thank goodness for the shirt, because it actually like showed people that at least she is there. In on television, it was just like a blip.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize, because I saw it on the big screen. And on the big screen, she's very clear. And even she's slightly in color. So you see that she's walking away. But on television, most people missed it. They didn't know it was her. And, you know, so everyone was like, oh, well, no body, then she must be, you know, alive. And I'm like, what are you talking about? There is a body. Like, she's walking away.
Yeah.
So luckily, the shirt the next day, like, explained to people, okay, that was Ahsoka. What form she's in, if she's alive or if she's a ghost, we don't know.
Right.
So yeah, I don't even know.
Well, and I think at that screening of the finale, Dave talked about,
yeah, you were there.
Yeah, he compared it to Gandalf, which I thought was so cool.
Oh, that's cool.
And I was like, so she's gonna come back as Ahsoka the White? Is that what's gonna happen? Which I think that shot in itself kind of, for me being a fan, I'm like, I think that she died in some way and is gonna come back in another form. That was what I gleaned out of him saying, kind of like Gandalf, but that's my guess.
I've always been a diehard Ahsoka fan from day one. She's my favorite character in the Clone Wars, not just because of Ashley, but because of what Ashley brings to it, but because of this character. Is the most relatable character in the Clone Wars, I think, to all of us. It's the one you can relate to and go, I get it. I would be in that position, and played beautifully by Ashley. But I am still going, she needs a spin-off movie or three movies. I mean, because this character is what made, now we've got all these wonderful characters in Star Wars that are female, but, you know, Ashley was around the beginning going, hey, you know, girl power in Star Wars. It's really important.
Well, the spin-off of that, there's two things. The first thing is that you've had such a road with this character, because it's highly documented that the character was not well received during that movie.
No,
that first
wasn't.
Movie, and I've told you this, and I've said it. When I saw that first movie in the theater, I was not a fan of it. And I said, I don't know why they're going to do this series. Yeah. I'm like, I don't know if these characters work. I don't need Anakin to have an apprentice. This isn't work. What is she calling him? I don't need this. And then the series happens. And I went back and I told myself, you shut up. And you watch this series because of what you just said. Ahsoka became that character that you said, okay, I buy this. I understand why she has this relationship. And you could tell how the relationship was nurtured. Can you speak a bit about how, first of all, the initial reception of Ahsoka, and then how it has just come through two seasons of Rebels now of really developing who she is?
Yeah, well, when the movie first came out, you know, because we had worked on the show for 2 years, and we were, prior to it coming out, we were so close to it. And so it was devastating at first when it came out and people hated it. Sure. And especially Ahsoka, people were like, it's the next Jar Jar Binks. So there was a day where my husband, he was playing baseball at the time, and we were in Boston. He was playing the Red Sox. I think they lost that game. And I stayed in the hotel all day with a giant piece of cheesecake from the Cheesecake Factory. I didn't even leave the room, and I made the mistake of reading all the message boards, and I was crying eating my cheesecake. And then I just like reminded myself, because we were a season ahead, and I knew where the character was going, and so I started to be positive, and I started asking the fans. That's awesome. I started saying, please be patient with her, go on this journey with her, because if she was perfect from the beginning, you wouldn't like her. Like, she's got to grow, she's got to go somewhere. And and so the fans did. And I think she was always meant to be the eyes of the audience. She was always meant to be that character that you related to. And you know, that goes to Dave and the writing staff. Like, they've just done such an amazing job writing the shows. And so I'm just grateful that the fans stuck with her. And then, you know, to what James said, I will say, yes, I'm biased, but I give so much credit to Lucasfilm and to Ahsoka, because in 2008, when she came out, it was literally unheard of to have a female character, a 14-year-old girl, as a lead. Yeah. She was the first female that was a Jedi that was a lead in the Star Wars universe. Groundbreaking. Yeah. Like, it caught people so by surprise. And then we had characters like Katniss and from The Hunger Games, Triss from Divergent, now Rey from Episode 7. Now these strong female characters are almost commonplace, but I do think Ahsoka had something to do with that. And it wasn't just me, it was an entire team of people. It takes an entire team, a village, to bring these characters to life. And it all started with George Lucas, Dave Filoni, and Henry Gilroy having the guts to say, we're going to have Anakin Skywalker have a Padawan, and it's going to be a 14-year-old girl.
You can tell how much Filoni loves the character. And this is what you mentioned, the standalone movie and everything.
Yeah.
I've been trying to champion this thing on this show. When I ran into Filoni at the premiere, I told him the same thing. I want Filoni to have his own standalone live action film. I want it to be Ahsoka Tano, and I want you to play her. That's exactly what I want to happen, and I hope that it does. Yeah. James, now speaking of Obi-Wan Kenobi here, because the only time we've seen him in Rebels so far is Holocaust. That's it. That's the only time they've seen him. What do you think he should come back? Do you think that he has a place in Rebels season three or four?
It's so funny because it's daily, you know, on Twitter. Oh, when is Obi? And I love how everybody asks me. So everybody that asks me, I don't have control of this. If it was up to me, it'd be, you know, and now it's time for that darn Obi-Wan. He'd have his own little spinoff, but it's not the way it works, you know? So my thought is this, like if, truly as a Star Wars fan, he shouldn't be on it.
Okay.
Because it doesn't make any sense. Yeah, it's playing too much of the, ooh, let's do a little cameo. Let's fly to this planet.
You know? Smaller universe.
Yeah. I mean, he is, if Obi-Wan is doing his job right, which we know through all of these films, that's, I mean, you know, I get goosebumps. He's passionate about this. Yeah. I love this character so much that I just don't think it makes sense for him to do anything but to watch Luke Skywalker grow and be in the Force, hoping, praying, whatever it is, that Luke redeems his father. That's where he's at this point. We got to remember that. We all look at it all from up here, and we see the whole world of it. Just like when we did the Clone Wars, I couldn't pretend that Anakin was going to become Darth Vader in my head. I could never go there.
Right.
He was the chosen one. That's where we were, and that's how it was. So now he's on a planet, and he's watching this one, and the Jedi is done. It's all gone. And now I will watch this one grow, and then hopefully he will become, you know, and we'll take him to Master Yoda at some point. That's his plan. Mm-hmm. So what are you going
to
do with that?
I happen to agree with you 100%.
Do you think, because I hear those sentiments and they make so much sense to me as a Star Wars fan, but also somebody who I wouldn't hate hearing the news that Obi-Wan Kenobi is getting a spinoff movie where it is an older, you know, Ewan McGregor playing Obi-Wan.
But as far as Rebels goes.
But as far as Rebels go, it doesn't fit in there. But even just having that character, it's do we need to see an adventure with him? Do you think that because you've been the character, is there enough meat in what he's doing, watching over Luke and having his own, you know, skirmishes with sand people to make a feature film?
Well, here's my little pitch. You know, feature film, that's great. TV show, TV series, spinoff of Obi-Wan on Tatooine and his adventures based off of the book Kenobi by John Jackson Miller. Yeah. That's my proposal. That'd be a couple seasons at least, and I'd be very happy. Although Ewan would go, oh, that's great. I want to do it. but even if he did, I'd watch it, and, you know, but I think that
and
would
cry
be
cry in your hotel room meeting.
I think that'll be a great series. The movies could be totally different. I mean, they could go anywhere with the films.
Who knows? And, you know, and again, hearing James, his interpretation of how Obi-Wan is thinking, which I loved, by the way. Thank you for doing that. When Ahsoka, because when I got a chance to interview you for season two, the premiere, we talked about whether or not if she knew, and she used to tell me Ahsoka doesn't want to even think that Anakin can go there. Mm-hmm. And then we find out that when it's revealed at the end, that heartbreaking moment when the mask is cracked and she sees it. What was that like, just going through and recording that moment, knowing this was the moment that we finally led up to? Well, can you take us through that?
Yeah, that was definitely an emotional day. Matt was there that day. And, you know, I think that's what helped put me in that place, because, you know, it was devastating for us when Clone Wars ended. We really were a family. And to have that time be done and be wrapped up, and we didn't know if we were ever going to work together again.
We were expecting two more seasons.
Yeah.
And so all of a sudden I find out that I'm back on Rebels, and then I get another day with Matt as Anakin and Ahsoka, something I never thought I'd get again, was such a gift. But then I realize this probably is the end. Like, I'm never going to get to record with Matt again. And then I was really upset about it. And it was just like, okay, once I realized this is it and it's done, I think me going to that place, that was also Ahsoka going to that place of like, Anakin's gone. Like, and that allowed her to then fight Darth Vader, because she wasn't fighting Anakin, she was fighting Darth Vader.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you really felt that in that moment for sure, because it was like, or even the I'm not a Jedi, and being that also allowed her to be able to do that. And that moment, which you could feel it. You could feel it through the performances and through the animation and everything. And you could see how much that moment meant for all you guys kind of coming through it. So congratulations on a great moment.
You guys got to get Matt Lanter in here.
We'd love to.
I mean, you know, when we did the episodes with Reiko Hardeen and all that, and Obi-Wan is thought to be dead. Spoiler alert for the Clone Wars. It's been out for a long time. Matt had to say Obi-Wan. That's all it said in the script. Obi-Wan. And he said it, and we do an ABC take. We do three takes of each line. And he did it, and Corey Burton's on one side of him. Corey Burton is a legend in voiceover. He was Count Dooku and Cad Bane and all these. And I'm on the other side of Matt. And he does this Obi-Wan, you know, like, and his voice cracks it. And we're both, like, tearing up. I mean, it's like, this guy could take so much. Yeah. And he did so much for this character. Nothing against the prequels ones and stuff, but he made this character, I think, so...
I thought it developed
relatable.
Him.
Too,
relatable.
Which, like, I think even putting a 14-year-old with him as his Padawan, it's like, you see that he has a heart, and that's what I needed to see to have that turn mean that much more, where it's like, he wasn't always this person. There were people that cared about him and loved him, and he had a heart, and he did have this connection to this other group of people. And so I think that he definitely brought that into the character.
Yeah. So what would you guys like to see happen in the upcoming seasons of Rebels? Well, you don't have to tell me what happens, but where do you think these characters, unlike Ahsoka, like speaking on characters maybe such as Kanan and Hera and even the Emperor and Vader, and all, where do you see these characters going from where we know them in Rebels now up until episode 4 and eventually the demise in episode 6? Where do you see these characters going?
You know, I am so intrigued to learn more about Kanan. I mean, now that he's blind,
right.
To get to watch this blind Jedi and now kind of even come into his powers more so, like, it's almost though he's become more powerful when this, you know, his sight is taken away. And to watch that evolution, I'm excited about. And then Sabine, you know, I don't know details, but I know it's going to be a big season for her. And to see another strong female character kind of grow and come into her own, I'm really excited about.
James?
Yeah, I thought it was a really bold, neat move to do that with Kanan and to take it into a whole other way to go. I got to be honest, you know, I mean, as a Star Wars fan, when Rebels was announced and such, and I knew about it beforehand because I had actually laid down some of the scratch track for the original, like, pilot thing, I was like, how are you going to do this? Because, I mean, it falls into a spot where I, as a Star Wars fan, go, don't touch that. I don't think you should touch that, especially if you got a movie coming out. And they've managed to do very well with it. So I'm kind of like, you know, Dave never ceases to amaze us. He would come in and, you know, it's the best thing in the world to be in a studio with Dave Filoni. He goes, all right, we're going to talk about Star Wars today. You know, and you're just like, and that's what he would do. He'd come into the studio and he would just, and if there's people that are guest stars, he would talk to us for like 45 minutes and they'd go, Dave, they're on the button going, Dave, you got to come in. We got to record. He just loves it. He's passionate about this. Yeah. And so... fans just need to trust that it's all in the right place. He knows what he's doing.
Let's talk a little bit more about Dave Filoni, because for me, it's like everything you hear from, no matter who it is that has worked with him, has nothing but great things to say about him. I have been able to speak to him, and I've got exactly what you said, how passionate he is and what he's doing. You see it in his work. What is it about Dave Filoni, though, that makes it like such a pleasure to work with? For you guys can speak obviously as talent, but also from watching him, how much respect and trust he has from Lucasfilm. And my last question out of that whole thing was, can he and should he do a spin-off live action film?
I think he should. I'm sorry, but
go ahead.
I think absolutely. I mean, for years we have sat in the, you know, I mean, I'm not kissing up. It's just he's a dear friend. He sat in his brilliance in cars, driving from restaurants back to the ranch, talking about Star Wars, sitting in the commissary there talking about Star Wars with him. He's got so much passion, but he's also a brilliant filmmaker. He should be doing so many things, and I hope they really see that and go, you know what? He should do one of these, because the other thing fans, people need to remember is he spent 8-10 years with George Lucas day to day. He's the only one. I mean, he's the guy that actually knows George's stuff. And I'm personally one of those only people that watched Force Awakens, loved it, thought it was a great movie, but I missed George's touch on it. I felt like I needed some George Lucas in that, which I didn't get. And
you think Filoni could add that?
Yes. Sure. Yeah.
Ashley?
You know, Dave is my favorite director I've ever worked with, by far. He's one of the most talented people I know, truly. And to me, you know, I think as actors, we talk about this. It's, you know, voice acting is acting. And sometimes, you know, they say, oh, well, could you do live action? Well, of course we can do live action. Acting's acting. Like, you know, but people are so quick to put you in a box and say, oh, well, you can't do live action because you just do voiceover. Well, I think the same goes for directing. They say, oh, well, you know, he just does animation. Can he do live action? Well, of course he can do live action. He is one of the most brilliant directors I've ever been around. And it's only a matter of time before he's going to do live action. And he's going to blow people's minds.
Yeah.
Like, they have no idea the talent in this man. And he's really going to become one of the greats. I just know it.
He's got so many wonderful stories in his head, you know, outside of Star Wars. And he, you know, again, it's to add on to what Ashley said, it works the same now. Movies are movies. Those cameras are in the CG world and they're moving them around. And he didn't just sit there and direct us. He directed the entire episode from the... Now, there needs to be more shade there. There needs to be some smoke there. The robe needs to flow more.
Yes.
Everything. And he knows what he's doing. Yeah.
Well, I think even hearing him talk on a panel about Star Wars in general, you hear him talk about the things that he pulls from, the things that he's reading, the things that he's watching, and bringing that into the film where he's like... I mean, he was talking about the C.S. Lewis letters... and the J.R.R. Tolkien letters, where he was like, if you haven't read them, read those, where it's like he just loves Star Wars so much, but also incorporates all of these other aspects to it. And he's a genius at not answering questions.
Oh, he's the best. So
if he did do a live action film, no one has to worry about him spoiling anything because he has got it down to a T.
You wouldn't know. I think that if he does one, it's got to be, you can tell how much he loves Ahsoka. You can see, because I was reading how Star Wars Conquered the Universe and hearing about the inception of Clone Wars, the show, and how it kind of came to be, and hearing Dave Filoni's pitch to George about Ahsoka, this character means a lot to him. So I think
fans should start telling all the folks there that they want Filoni's take on it.
I'm telling you, I've been asking you guys for a while now. Continue to do it again. Filoni for a standoff. I really think that it's a push, it's a movement that I'd be happy to run, even though we can't get Filoni on the show. all right. Now, before last question I'd like to ask you guys before we move on to the Twitter questions is Ezra. We have to talk about Ezra. There are so many fan theories out there. So many people thought, this is Snoke. This is whoever. Yeah. This is all these because.
His eyes turn red?
This is another thing with him going down the dark path. This is another. Now, Ahsoka has now seen a couple of strays here and there. Like, so did she ever pick up that he is teetering on the dark side? Because he's teetering. So I didn't know if the character had picked it up at that point. I don't know if this was a...
I mean, I'm sure Ahsoka has picked something up. I'm confused about Ezra, and I can't wait to find out more. Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm just as intrigued as everyone. Did his eyes turn red? Or, you know, why does he have so much power? He's so powerful. Right. He has, you know, like, I don't know. I have a million questions, but I'm sure Ahsoka has picked up on something. But Ashley, I don't know.
Yeah. Jane, what do you think?
It's tough because, again, this goes back to my first reaction of this show in general. It's like, well, this is a Disney show. Disney XD, Rebels, you know. Ezra's evil. You know, it's just, it seems, yeah, you go, one of these things is not like the other. I don't know, but they're going to have to deal with him in some way, right? Yeah. Just like we knew we were going to have to deal with Ahsoka in some way. It's a lot easier to deal with Ahsoka, though, than these characters. And even Kanan, you know, where did these characters go? I mean, because they weren't around in the movies that started it all, so.
All right.
Well, and I think what we haven't asked yet is, do you guys think that characters from Rebels could end up in the films? I mean, I know there's a lot of people who've said they would love to see Ahsoka appear somewhere within the world. Do you guys think that any Rebels characters will?
Well, I think now more than ever, because Disney, you know, has made the promise, like all the Marvel movies, they all connect. Everything connects. It's all a part of canon. It's all a part of the story now. So I think it's possible now more than ever. So I don't know. I'd be thrilled to see these characters in the films.
Yeah.
Yeah. It'd be fun.
James, point blank, are you doing any voices in Rebel Season 3?
No.
Okay. Fair enough.
That's a hard-hitting question.
It's a hard-hitting question.
It's nice to know that it's not just a gig for you guys.
Yeah.
You know? Like, seriously, like, as a Star Wars fan, like, I know you guys look at me like, oh, he's so handsome and funny, but it's like, I'm really small down here, and it's like, you guys are in the Star Wars universe, and you still care so much about this source material. Like, it's just, it's really cool to, no matter how big you are in Star Wars universe, you still need Cheesecake Factory every so often. I think that's great.
Now, you guys got to hear from us. You got to hear from both Ashley and James. Now, how about you guys? We want to hear from you guys. Actually, no, you know what? I forgot. There's something that we have first. Address the council, don't we? We have address the council. Let's do that.
Yeah.
I have to do that today. I forgot that I was going to do this. So we haven't done this in a little bit. This is address the council, where one of us will just address both everyone here at the council and then directly to you guys out there as well. I will be addressing the council today, and it will be about this billboard that has gone up to where fans, this thing, the original expanded universe, the epic story that exists from 76 to 2014.
Would it give us,
you don't understand legends? What you're give asking for. You don't understand what you're asking for. You're basically telling them to kill Chewie, to kill Luke, or make him a clone. You're asking them, because you can't pick and choose. You can't say, make some of it canon and then not the rest of it, because from where we are, everything past Legends that used to be, that is now Legends, in the that will now be canon. So Chewie is killed by a moon. You can't have Chewie. No, it's stupid. It doesn't make sense. There's a reason why cherry pick all these things. And now you guys, and I understand the passion behind it. You don't think I want the Darth Plagueis novel to be canon? Of course I do. You know, there's the Darth Bane and the Old Republic. I want all that stuff to be canon. But you get what they're giving us now. They're putting together this brand new storyline and this nice timeline. Deal with it. Accept it. There's too much of that stuff that's behind in the past that just doesn't work anymore. It just doesn't. Because if you don't want Rian Johnson's take, and you don't want, that's what you're asking for. You're saying get rid of everything they're doing on Episode 8 now. Kill that. Because if they take Legends and make that canon now, then everything in Episode 8 is gone. You're asking them to destroy stories. It just, I get the passion, but it doesn't make sense. Does anybody else on the council think that this stuff should be canon?
First of all, that was a really fast-moving moon, okay? So, like, it would have hit any of us and killed us.
Right.
Second of all, are they necessarily saying, and I haven't visited the website, because research isn't my thing, but if I went to this website, are they saying we want to continue those stories and make them canon? Because I know everything that comes out under the Star Wars logo is now considered canon. But what if we lived in a world when you could write new Star Wars stories and they necessarily didn't have to be canon right away? So you could continue that universe the same time you're continuing the canon Star Wars
universe. Confusing.
It's
confusing.
But that's just called fan fiction.
Yeah.
At that point.
I get that.
Why can't we have fan fiction?
But Lucasfilm and Del Rey and all those companies shouldn't be doing, because it's too confusing to fans. Because when you put something on, then look at all the questions Pablo Hidalgo gets about canon now. all the stuff. If so, they start putting out fan fiction. Well, wait a minute. Is this canon? The guy would lose his mind. There's too much. It would be too much. And it's just, you have to. I understand. There's some great stories that we lost. This Timothy Zahn stuff. It's great. But the thing is, the second you say, okay, you know what? You guys are right. We're gonna make all this stuff canon. Force Awakens is gone. Now Mara Jade is back and all this stuff. And I love Mara Jade. I love Thrawn. But introduce him in different ways.
Well, and I think if you're a comic book reader, this is something that was easier to swallow, because it's like, how many times do they reboot comic book universes? Yeah. New 52 comes out. And now they're like, oh, we're going to do this thing. Something else comes out. And they're like, those stories are no longer part of this story's canon. But can directors and people, story writers who are really excited about some of that stuff that happened in the past, bring it back in and cherry pick, which is what we've kind of seen starting to happen? That I think is the best of all the worlds, where it's like, okay, the stuff like Chewie being killed by Moon can go away, but the stuff that works really well, we can figure out a way to infuse that back into the Star Wars universe. And I think that is something, as a comic book reader, you see happen all the time, and it does work.
Yeah, I think that it's probably what they want, is that like whether it's continuing, what happened to Thrawn? What happened? And I understand that. I really do. But it's like, it just doesn't fit the narrative that they're telling right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, I mean, the books are all there. The stories are all there. Just read them again.
Right.
And move on. Right. I don't get it.
I think they want to continue it like Mark was alluding to, but it doesn't work for them.
No, I don't think it works. And people have to remember that Pablo and all the folks there, they have gone through months and months and months. We heard about them just figuring it all out. It wasn't just like, oh yeah, we'll do this and that. they thought about this stuff. Right. So cut them a break, man.
But hey, if Pablo needs help, he can call my mom.
That's right.
Because
she thinks that she's got it figured out.
Yeah, your mom should call these people and tell them to cut it out. Okay, now we get to you guys. You guys have submitted your tweets. We're going to read a few of them. Mark, let's see if we can get them going.
All right. Well, I don't know what order I'm going to be reading them in, Christian, but that's part of the charm of this
Jedi
program.
Order.
Up first is Maverick Hart. So, are we going to find out that Snoke Plagueis is in that back-to-tank in Rogue One?
No, I don't. This is the stupendous wave who makes great YouTube videos. He put this theory out there, and got a lot of people talking about it. That the shot. Are you guys supposed to see the Rogue One trailer?
I've seen it, but I hadn't. Now I heard about this after I saw it, and I'm like, I didn't know what to look for.
So the Rogue One trailer, there's a hooded figure who some have said maybe it's Vader in a particular outfit, maybe it's the Emperor because you have the two guards there, but there's a tank. And he's kneeling. So if it's the Emperor, who's the Emperor kneeling to?
And there's royal guards on either side of him. Yeah. They don't show up for just anybody.
Right. So the theory is that it's the Emperor kneeling to what used to be Darth Plagueis, which eventually turns into Snoke, and that's how he's introduced. It's a fun theory, but I'm going to say it's a big no. Everybody else?
Yeah.
I saw the trailer, but I missed that part.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't hate it. I don't know. I don't have a strong feeling on it one way or another yet. I got to get more of a grip on Rogue One.
I don't hate the theory. I just don't think it's...
I think the way they're doing Rogue One, too, is like, yes, Darth Vader's going to be in it. He's going to be whooping some ass, but they're still going to differentiate themselves from Force Awakens. Like, hey, this is a Star Wars anthology. This is a Star Wars story. We're not reliant on all the nostalgia from the movie you just saw to sell it. We have our own story that we're telling her.
Well, in that particular shot, when I saw it, I thought that was Vader. When I saw it the first time, I was like, I thought it was Vader going to talk to the Emperor, and that would be why he would be kneeling. It's just we haven't seen that angle on him with the hood up.
I think there's no way that's Vader. It
didn't feel like it, right?
I have an eye for Vader, okay? I'm not good at many things, but I can spot a Darth Vader when I see one. It just didn't look like, to my naked eye, when I was sitting in the airport at LAX at 5 in the morning watching that, I was like, I don't think that's Vader. Maybe that dude's going to visit Vader, but I don't know.
All right, what's next?
Up next is, I believe, Caleb Samples. Yeah, 2 for 2. Mm. Does Ahsoka ever know about the marriage of Anakin and Padme towards the end of Clone Wars or after Episode 3? I believe that is aimed at Miss
Ahsoka Tano.
Well, you know, at the end of Season 5 when she walks away, you know, Anakin says, Ahsoka, you know, I understand more than you know. And she says, I know. Yeah. And that moment is her saying, I know about you and Padme.
Right.
Yeah. So to me, that moment confirms she knows. I mean, she had been figuring it out for a while. And Dave and I talked about that. Like James said, Dave would give us like at least a 30 to 45 minute breakdown of every episode prior to recording it. So I had figured that she knew for a while, but that moment confirmed it.
Yeah.
Right. And usually when you say I know in the Star Wars universe, it means more than just I know what you're talking
nice.
About.
Nice. Yeah. All right. What's next?
Catherine S. writes in and she asked, have they ever had an opportunity to read the new canon novels, such as Dark Disciple? Either one of you guys?
No, you know, we talked about this a little beforehand, that I spent so much time in a cave not reading anything other than the scripts when we got them, when we walked in the room, because I didn't want it to, you know, flavor me in any way. And now I'm like just waiting for some vacation time to sit back and actually read some of these books. I'm excited about it because people were talking about them like they're really good. I don't know.
Yeah. No, just like James said, in the beginning, we were encouraged not to be influenced by the books. And this was when, you know, they were the expanded universe. Right. But, you know, we did ask Dave.
They got a billboard for that now.
Yeah, there's a billboard for that. Who knows? Maybe my mom's running that campaign. I don't know. But
that'd be the greatest thing ever. We need to have your mom on the reveal.
Yeah. It's the shot of your mom from behind. Closed and she turns around.
have the billboard.
But I'm actually excited. Just like James said, I'm looking forward to a vacation to read the books, especially the new Ahsoka book coming out.
Yeah.
You know, Dave and Pablo, you know, they are definitely involved in influencing that story. And it is telling kind of a segment of what happened between Clone Wars and Rebels.
Right.
So now I'm excited about these books because it is information that we've been wanting that right. I don't even know. So I look forward to it.
Yeah, and you know, Dark Disciple, by the way, I would, especially for Clone Wars, it's one of my favorite ones. Mm-hmm. And it does, you learn a lot about what happens to Asajj Ventress and with Quinlan Voss. And what it was, it's either four unfinished scripts that I believe George Lucas's daughter wrote. Some of them as well, too. And then it was given to Christy Golden, who wrote the novel. It was a really, really good book. It's definitely in my, I'd say, in my top five. And this,
and there's fun Obi Wan stuff in it too.
Can you hand me that? Thanks, James.
Ooh,
news the polls.
Thank you very much. So, this one, I was asked if I was allowed to talk about it. I got an early copy of Bloodline. You guys know how much I love,
and I'm gonna take it steal home it. With me.
How much I love Lost Stars. Now I have not finished it. I'm about 100 pages into this one right now. This is 6 years before The Force Awakens. Leia is on a mission now it's politics, but there's also the questions that are answered that I wanted to know. I was like, well, I wonder if this person is around, or are they doing this? It's answered in this book, like you had just mentioned. There are questions, these mm-hmm. questions that I wanted to know, and Claudia Gray, just, she's great. She's just a great writer. I'm 120 pages in. I can't imagine it's going to be such a shift that I'm going to change my opinion on her as a writer. But she just understands Star Wars, man. She just gets it. She understands how to incorporate classic characters without making it go like, hey, I've got to be writing Star Wars right now. I'm writing Star Wars. You're there. It's Leia. It's Leia talking. And then she introduces new characters. That was my problem with Aftermath, is that Aftermath, to me, there's too many new characters mm-hmm. in a way that it just didn't feel like Star Wars at some points, and the writing kind of took me out of it, as where Lost Stars introducing old characters with new characters, and the same thing with Bloodline. So far, so good. I will review it in full in a couple of weeks. So just wanted to give you guys the heads up there.
So if you have newbies like them, if you're going to start them on a book? Are you starting them with Lost Stars?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
You guys should both, on your vacation, start with Lost Stars for sure. Okay. What's next?
All right. Well, next up is somebody by the name of Jaden. No numbers. Oh. We don't need any. Do you think Dave Filoni could one day get a live action movie to himself, or do you think he will stick to TV? You know, Christian, this is a topic we haven't touched on yet.
This goes back to the last John Campion note of having the production meeting before. I think everyone's on board again to the two. Besides, so if there was, let's go from us first, and then they can decide if they want to jump in here. If there was a movie that you could see Dave Filoni in the Star Wars universe direct, what would it be?
Ooh, let's see. Not Jabba the Hutt movies. That's Martin Scorsese.
Right.
If I was going to see Dave Filoni do one movie, I think I would like to see his spin on what Obi-Wan's been doing.
Obi-Wan.
Yeah.
Okay. Tiff?
I mean, we didn't talk about this. We talked about him doing films, but I really would love him to see him. I would love to see him do a live action television show, because I think he does such a good job with episodic. Hmm. That seeing him do something like that, possibly the Old Republic, would be really cool. So anything where it's serialized like that, I think, is something that I would rather see him do than just one film and be done.
Old Republic's a great idea, because you can tell from his introduction of Darth Bane into the universe, and then almost putting Darth Revan into the mm-hmm. universe. And even looking at the season finale, he knows the lore so well.
And how to introduce a dark character in a way that's not just like, here's a villain.
Yeah.
Like, there's so much depth to them.
Netflix, Amazon, definitely. But I'm pushing for an Ahsoka Tano movie during the times of after episode 3, leading up to when we see her in Rebels.
Yeah, and then, you know, I was very honored to voice Plo Koon in the shows as well. Mm. And Dave, again, would call Gandalf. His direction to me was Gandalf. And Plo Koon and Ahsoka have a wonderful connection. Yeah. Plo Koon found Ahsoka. Mm-hmm. People know that, right?
Now, yeah.
I would love a movie, and I would love them to go back and tell that in flashbacks of how she was a little toddler, and Plo Koon finds her. It's beautiful. If you ever see any of Dave Filoni's art on this stuff, it's just fantastic.
Ashley, do you have anything that you think he should do if he was going to do one? If you were giving him advice as a friend, and you're like, this is the one that you should go after. Or your mom. What would your mom tell him?
Tell him. Actually, she does tell him. No, she does. Every single time. I'm not joking. There's a book called Julie and the Wolves, and Dave Filoni loves wolves. She gave it to him years ago, and she's an elementary school teacher, and she, every single time, she goes up to him, and she's like, now, Dave, did you read Julie and the Wolves yet? I'm telling you, that needs to be a movie. It would be a huge hit. And I'm like, Mom, just give it a rest.
That was so good.
But no, I mean, I'd love to see him have any opportunity in live action. I know he has some of his own ideas. But in terms of Ahsoka, of course, selfishly, I would love that.
Right.
But I, if anything is done with Ahsoka, I hope it is him, because it is like Ahsoka is like his child essentially, and so he knows that character better than anyone else. But I just want him to have the opportunity, no matter what the story is.
All right, what's the next one?
Up next is going to be Knights of Meme. Hey, he's wearing a Schmoes No shirt. Good taste in wardrobe, and his question's great. What is your all-time favorite memory from working on Clone Wars?
Boy.
You look like you, you know something. What? I do have an answer to this because it involves you as well.
Oh, come on.
No, you know, one of my favorite memories from Clone Wars was recording the Mortis trilogy.
Oh, so
and that was the first time we got to work with Sam Witwer.
Yeah.
And then, of course, any day in the studio with James and Matt, you know, those were some of my favorite because that was like getting the gang together.
Right. Yeah.
And not every episode, you know, did we star in together. So those episodes, those three episodes, just a really great cast, really cool story. I mean, we had dark side, older Ahsoka, younger Ahsoka. Like we all got.
I got to do, you're the chosen one.
Yes. Yeah. There were some great moments, but you know, those have always been some of my favorite episodes. But now I think there's some connection with the Mortis trilogy and what's going on with Ahsoka right now.
Hmm.
That fan theory that's out there, I do believe there's some truth to it. Hmm. That's just my opinion.
What's the fan theory?
So if you look at the Convery, like the owl, the bird,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
she's the same color as the daughter from Mortis. Or the bird has the same colors as the daughter from Mortis. And the fans have pointed that out, and it's true. And the daughter gave up her life for Ahsoka, because Ahsoka died in the Mortis trilogy, right. and the daughter gave up her life. And so I think there's some sort of connection with the daughter and now this bird. And like, I got to go back and watch that trilogy.
Yeah, I want to watch that too.
Mm. Yeah.
Man, we just had fun. Obi-Wan spent his whole time in that. Do you remember we... this is so inappropriate. We'd call him Alzheimer's Obi, because he kept, what are we doing? Where are we?
That's what? True.
What are you doing, Anakin? What time of day is it? He didn't know anything in those episodes. He was just walking around. Am I a Jedi? Those were really some of my favorite moments, too. And then I also loved when we got to do the stuff with Satine in the last seasons with Darth Maul. Again, spoiler alert, where Satine and Maul have their time and getting to do that. It was Anna Graves, who played Satine, did such a wonderful job as well. And those were great. But I mean, there's too many. I mean, our whole lives have been affected by this.
Yeah.
You know, people go, oh, my life was affected by Star Wars. And I would have said that as a fan, you know, up until these last few years. And now it's been affected in a totally new way. I've got to do things. We've been on stage with everybody. We've done so many things, and it's all because of the Clone Wars. So it's kind of, it's all that. You know, Ashley and I get to spend every summer together at Star Wars weekends doing all that. And it's gone now. But, you know. We've had so many wonderful moments from it all. And we really are a family. I was telling you this.
Yeah.
We're a family. We all stay in touch. We all still talk to each other, text each other. It's just unlike any other show I've ever worked on.
It's really awesome. All right, what's next?
Andrew Day is up next. And he writes, Ashley Eckstein, how is it different playing Obi or Ahsoka in the video game compared to Rebels clones? I guess he threw that to you, James, too.
Both yeah.
It'd be weird if he asked Ashley, what's it like to play Obi-Wan? Right.
I think it would be weird, but do that. That'd be good.
Oh, gosh. No, they would never have me do the crazy voices because it always sounded like Ahsoka. But, you know, it was the same. I mean, really, the performance, but Dave Filoni never wrote, and his crew never wrote the video games. And so sometimes we'd go in, and I'd have some lines where I remember one time I walked in and they had Ahsoka saying yee-haw. Mm. And, you know, I'm like, I'm sorry, Ahsoka would never say yee-haw. So it was, you know, it was really the same performance-wise, but you know, you record an entire video game in one day. Sometimes it's like 5 hours because and it's just you by yourself. Versus Clone Wars and Rebels, we record
we're
as a cast.
Right, right.
So sometimes it's a bit lonely. You know, you're all by yourself, yelling, screaming, and
little padded room talking to yourself.
That sounds like
James
Thursday.
Knows about that.
Yeah, no. And when I do the games, I'd do Plo Koon and Obi-Wan, and then if they had other little characters or droids or whatever. So you spend half the day talking like this and the other half talking like this, and sometimes they talk to each other. But it's a lot of times, as you say, you had to correct them. You go, that line doesn't fit. It doesn't make sense. It's always different. Video games are very different. They're very strenuous work, you know, because, again, there's no break in it. You just read, and there's so much to get through. So it's fun because we got to do them again, like for Infinity and stuff, but it's just not the same experience.
Yeah. All right, Mark, What's next?
Next up is, I believe, is it Maverick Hart? No, we got rid of him. He's fired. It's Noah Outlaw. And he asked the question that we've touched on, Ashley. Will we ever see Ahsoka in a live action movie?
Ooh. You know, I hope so. I really do. I really hope so. You know, whether I ever got to play her or not, I am a fan of this character. And I do think the way that Rebels left off, I think it did leave that possibility open. I mean, even if she is alive or dead, like, it left on a question. And I still don't feel that's the end of her story. We need more. And so I hope it's in a live action movie. You know, as a fan, I want that.
All right, two more.
All right, let's do Derek next. Derek, could Ahsoka have a place post-Return of the Jedi? And if so, what could a role be? May the Force be with you.
Well, that's all of us, too. So it could post-Return of the Jedi. Now, the thing is that people will throw back, well, wait a minute. Yoda said that there's no more Jedi left. The last of the Jedi will be. Ahsoka clearly says in Rebels, you do. I'm not a Jedi. So he didn't say no Force users were around. He said that there was no Jedi left. So could she have a place? Yes. I particularly don't know if she needs to by the end of Return of the Jedi. I think because then you're going to start having, well, how come they don't use her more and things? Because I don't know what her lifespan for her species is. You probably know better than I do. I don't know. So I don't think that she should. I still, like I said just beforehand, I want to see her in other stories throughout time. Does anybody else think she would pop up around that time?
I think it'd be kind of a stretch to kind of try to make it work. It'd be weird. I'd rather see her standalone. Yeah.
All right.
She knows something. Yeah, she knows something.
She's no like, comment. Well, shoot, you guys are saying you don't want to see it. That's the standalone movie.
No, I do not know anything. I know that. When the fact that she says, I'm no Jedi, she's making a very strong point. And that was pointed out a lot in Rebels that she's no longer a Jedi. So whatever that means, it means something. And so hopefully that gets explored at some point.
It should be noted, Yoda, I love the guy to death. Dude was 900 years old, man. Mm-hmm. So he might have missed some nuggets here and there of information.
True.
But, I mean, he does say the last of the Jedi. So it's a nice out because I'm sure George Lucas, 1983, didn't really know what, you know, even as popular Star Wars was back then, how many stories would be built around these characters. She could be hanging out with Maz Kanata somewhere, because Maz, also, it's made a note in Force Awakens, like, I'm aware of the Force, I know the Force, but I ain't a Jedi.
And the cutscenes where she uses the Force.
Mm-hmm. Right.
She's not a Jedi. I still love, too, that line made me, I'm a huge Lord of the Rings fan, obviously, but it makes me immediately think of I'm no man.
Yeah.
When she says that line in the movie,
too. The last two.
I think you already said two, but
last
I'll give
one.
You one,
last one. Last one. Last
you
one. Last one.
Behave yourself.
Sorry.
Up next is it going to be Andrew? Or is it going to be Jack? We just have to wait to find out. It is Andrew Day yet again. Question for James Arnotero and Ashley Eckstein: how did the two of you get the roles of Obi-Wan and Ahsoka? And at the time, did you know it was Star Wars?
You want to go first?
Well, for me, I auditioned just like anything else. I found out the night before the audition, but I went in and auditioned for Padme. Oh. And I almost did not go into the audition because I had practiced all day for Padme, and I knew I didn't sound like Natalie Portman. I sounded nothing like her. I did a horrible Natalie Portman. And I called my agent, and I was like, look, I don't sound like her. And he said, you know what? Go in. Go in anyway. You never know what'll happen. And I'm so glad I listened to him because Ahsoka was so top secret, they didn't even advertise her. And so, sure enough, they cut me off after the first line, and they're like, you sound nothing like Padme. And they said, but you might be right for this new character. So we knew it was Star Wars. I knew it was a new Star Wars show. But I personally didn't know anything about Ahsoka until my first day of work. So when I showed up is literally when they told me who I was playing and what I was doing. And then they said, oh, by the way, you can't tell anyone for 2 years.
Wow.
So did they give you lines for Ahsoka when they were like, not Padme in that audition? Or?
Yeah, but they were very generic lines. They weren't even Ahsoka lines. They could have just been anything. I remember saying a line about the Clone Wars, but it was probably even like an Obi-Wan line, and it had nothing to do with Ahsoka. Yeah. So they luckily, it was actually my kind of body movements and personality in between takes right. that got me the role. Mm-hmm. Because I would never normally do this, but I spoke back to Dave Filoni, and he told me he wanted me to do an Icelandic accent, and I was terrible at it, but I went to a dialect coach and literally like learned an Icelandic accent, and it was Dave that didn't know what an Icelandic accent sounded like. And so he was, I said the first line and he stopped me and he's like, no, I want it more Icelandic. And I paused and I raised my hand and I said, I'm sorry, but I am doing Icelandic, so I don't know what you want. Yeah. And it turns out that that's what got me the part. Wow. And so they called me, they said, you got the part, and they said, but we don't want you to do Icelandic. You have to do your regular voice.
Now, it's one thing to get a new character because yeah. someone that's going to eventually have that road. It's something to get Obi Wan Kenobi.
It's a whole yeah. other that, yeah, ball man. Of wax, man. Well, okay, so years earlier, 2002, I auditioned for the micro series of the Clone Wars, which I didn't know was going to be a micro series. I thought it was. I had done a lot of Ewan McGregor's doubling for things like Moulin Rouge, and then there uh-huh. was just other stuff. And like when he's doing an American accent, which is very similar to my regular. So like he's just talking in an American voice. He talks like this, and then if you give him, you know, whichever accent he wants to do at the time. So I thought, okay, I could do that. And then they gave me the stuff, and they, you know, episode 1 and 2 had already been made. So they played me some of that, and I went, okay, I could do it. I thought it was just going to be for like a trailer to fill in some of his dialogue, because that's what I would do in the past. And I didn't go, I'm going to do Obi-Wan, or I didn't say, I'm going to do Ewan McGregor, or I'm going to do Alec Guinness, I'm going to do Obi-Wan Kenobi, is what I had in my head. I thought, I'm just going to do Obi-Wan. And he happens to sound like Ewan McGregor. So at the time, I was doing, when I do him, it's much higher. You see, it's different, and it's not the Obi-Wan that you hear on the show. It's become its own thing. But so I auditioned for it, and then my agents, they call and they go, you got this part, and it's in a Star Wars cartoon. And I literally dropped the phone. I'm like, are you kidding? No, it was just a trailer. And they said, no, this is a cartoon they're going to do of Star Wars. And I was like, well,
that's the best.
I've died. And, and then they brought me back in. You know, so I had been doing him in all the games and stuff, and they went, oh, we'll use you for the games. And they were making Revenge of the Sith at the time, and so we did the video game of it, and they played me a bunch of the movie before. It was all blue screen, and I got to see the big, you know, you are my brother Anakin, and I had to recreate all of that. Wow. And when we did that, that's when they went, oh, this guy's our Obi-Wan, like for good now. And then they called and sat with Dave and Henry Gilroy, and they had me read for Anakin and Obi-Wan, because they weren't settled in on Anakin yet. And because they weren't going to use the same actor from the micro series, who was a great guy, Matt Lucas did great. But so I read us both, and I was like, I was doing Christian, you know, it was like he's almost like Christopher Walken, Hayden Christensen. You know, he kind of does this with every, you know, no, he stretch, and it's almost that, you know. So I was like, I don't know. I go, you're not going to like this, and they're like, yeah, don't do that, just do Obi-Wan. So I did Obi-Wan, and I knew, you know, that they were going to stick with me, so I was very fortunate. But it was the coolest thing in the world. Plo Koon was really the coolest, because again, I'm a big Lord of the Rings fan, yeah, too. So that was the first day I worked with you guys. Mm-hmm. And Matt Lanter, they brought him in, and Matt and Ashley were in this, and I was doing Plo Koon. It wasn't Obi-Wan in the first couple of episodes, and I went, oh man, these two are fantastic. That's I cool. get it. They're so wonderful. So.
Have you ever interviewed or sat down with Ewan McGregor? Like
no,
really?
No. I'd love to.
I am.
The best story is there was a. Did you go to the red carpet thing for the 35 year of Empire Strikes
no,
Back?
I missed
they
it.
You were out of town. So okay, they bring us, and Kat Tabor and I are there, and we're on the red carpet. And they're taking pictures of us. No, it's great. And they have this precious little girl who was like a Make a Wish type thing. It wasn't Make a Wish, I don't think, but it was another one. And I'm signing autographs for her, and she goes, there's Ewan McGregor! And everybody goes, and it was like, and I'm like, standing there with my pen. And I was really hoping to meet him that day, but it just didn't happen.
Goal for Jedi Council.
Yeah.
There you go. Guys, what an amazing, amazing episode. So happy to have you guys finally on the council. Would love to have you back.
Yeah.
All right, Mark 2D2. Tell them where they can find you.
Well, before I plug myself, I got to make sure that I let everybody out there know in Colliderville that I got to sit down with not only James Arnold Taylor, who's a very nice guy if you've never met him, and David Kay, who's the other star of Ratchet and Clank. That interview goes up next week on Collider's YouTube channel, and you can catch a little snippet tonight on the Schmoes No Live Show. As for me, you can just follow me on Twitter at Mark Ellis Live. I'll be at the Albany Funny Bone next weekend. Upcoming dates include the Houston Improv and the Minneapolis Acme Comedy Club, the same comedy club that at one time kicked out Kristian Harloff.
That's true. true. Ooh. Very true. It's a good story. For another time. I'm masking out again. So, Ashley, Eckstein, Ahsoka Tano herself, where can the good people find you?
They can find me on just at Her Universe on Instagram, Twitter, the Her Universe official Facebook page, and HerUniverse.com.
And Plo Koon, Obi-Wan Kenobi, James Arnold Taylor, where can I find you, sir?
Jat Actor is my handle for Instagram, Twitter. I'm on Twitter all the time. If you know, you see it and you, it's me responding. Go to JamesArnoldTaylor.com and find all the other links and stuff, too.
And the Smith Lord, Tiffany Smith, where can they find
me? You guys can find me on social media at Tiffany's Tweets. And on Fandango, I actually got to do the panel for you guys for Ratchet and Clank, but I did another interview with Bella Thorne that will be up, I think, later this week or next week. So check that out. And then obviously always on DCL Access.
Very cool. For me, you can find me at Kristian Harloff, at Kristian Harloff, Twitter and Instagram. And if you're watching this show right now, chances are that the Schmoes Know live show is going to be happening very soon, 7 o'clock, 7 to 9 p.m. We're talking about fantasy movies tonight and whether or not the genre can be helped out. It is hurting right now, and can it be saved? We need one of those, you know, the yeah.
I don't know what that was.
You guys got it.
Yeah, clear.
Clear. He got it. Yeah. Oh, you know what? I don't need a Smith Lord to know. I need Obi-Wan to know, and he did. So that's it. That's our show. Thank you guys so much, and as always, may the Force be with you.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.